The West is not the only producer of great literature. Philosopher Hegel recognized that India has produced some of the most magnificent work this world has ever known. As I mentioned earlier in previous classes, many 19th and 20th century thinkers and writers found an ancient Sanskrit text from India that fascinates them. It even inspired them in some of their work. This text has been the Bible of India, known as the Bhagavad Gita, which means the Song of God. Before we start considering some of the passages from this great text, I would like to call to your attention what our American literary masters think about this work. Ralph Waldo Emerson, a great writer and poet who lived in New England in the 19th century, wrote these words about the Bhagavad Gita in his journal in 1848. I owed a magnificent day to the Bhagavad Gita. It was as if an empire spoke to us, nothing small or unworthy, but large, serene, and consistent. The voice of an old intelligence, which in another age and climate had pondered and thus disposed of the same questions which exercise us. Now, it should be obvious from these words that Emerson held the Gita in very high esteem. And he was not alone. His comrade Henry David Thoreau, another great philosopher and writer, wrote these astonishing words about the Gita while he was in nature at Walden Pond. I bathed my intellect in the vast and cosmological philosophy of the Gita, since whose composition years of the gods have elapsed, and in comparison with which our modern world and its literature seem puny and trivial.
What was it exactly that fascinated these great authors with the Bhagavad Gita? I'm sorry, I know I'm not pronouncing that name right.
Your attempt at pronouncing the Sanskrit language was noble. It's Bhagavad Gita. Why don't you try pronouncing the name again?
Bhagavad Gita.
Much better. And your question is very good. Perhaps the Gita opened up areas of human experience that these writers never experienced in any literature of the West. Let's begin to explore some of these exquisite passages now.
I'm very happy that I've come back.
I'm also happy, Swamiji, to see you so relaxed.
You said you were here before. How did you like it?
I was very different back then. I came to India in search for spiritual life, but I did not know what spiritual life actually meant. I was drifting like a cloud. It was a nice experience, but there was nothing spiritual about it. I was just sort of floating with time. When I was in Benares, I would often go to the Ganges and just sit on the riverbank there. I met quite a lot of sadhus, but I can't say I met anybody who impressed me.
I'm happy that you are not impressed. Otherwise, you would not have come to me.
That's my good fortune, Swamiji.
See, I feel so much tired. And I'm not able to get sleep. What is this?
That's common after you take a long plane ride.
Is it?
They call it jet lag.
Oh.
You won't be able to sleep for a couple of days, but then you'll be really tired, and then your body will adjust.
Thank you. Is this so? Thank you very much.
Swamiji.
Oh, Panditji. How are you?
Did you get a good rest, Swamiji?
Not quite well. I'm feeling tired, but I could not get sleep. Kirtananda is telling me that after a long flight, it often happens. They call it jet lag.
I had to go in the morning to see some people. I have just come.
Oh. Now you can go. I will sit here for some time and talk to Panditji.
Thank you, Swamiji.
So, how was America, Swamiji?
It was very nice. Lots of young boys and girls were becoming Christians. Even though previously they did not know who Krishna is. Due to my preaching, they are accepting him as the Supreme Personality of Godhead and surrendering to him wholeheartedly. You see, Krishna Pandit, I have implicit faith that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's prediction will come true.
Seeing him in India is helping me to understand him even better. I can see how detached he is.
Kirtananda? Kirtananda?
Coming, Swamiji.
Can you play our Hare Krishna album for Krishna Pandit?
Yes, Swamiji.
You must hear it. It is wonderfully done.
When I went to America, I did not have the slightest idea what kind of response I would get there. In the beginning, it was a little difficult, but Krishna always used to take care of me. When I went there first, I did not have even the idea where I would stay, what I would eat, but the son of a friend of mine, Gopal, he made all arrangements for my stay with him when I arrived there. He married one American girl called Sally. She's a very nice girl and she used to take care of me like my own daughter. They live in a small town called Butler in Pennsylvania. The people there were also nice to me. They used to come and hear my lectures, and sometimes they also invited me to their houses. Hundreds of them have accepted the standard and become devotees of Krishna. I have given initiation to many of them. This is Kirtananda Das, and he is one of my first disciples in New York. I will someday bring all of them to India and you will see how sincerely they have accepted the Vaishnava way of life.
I am very glad to receive your first letter to me in India. So far as Bhagavad Gita is concerned, please complete it as soon as possible. Although I am practically on the path of death, I want to see that at least our Bhagavad Gita is published in America. Regarding separation, you may know that I am also feeling that way. In the transcendental field, the feeling of separation is more valuable than the feeling of meeting. Physically, I am trying to go back to the United States as soon as possible. I have a fancy for your country. Regarding your dilemma about accepting a teaching position, Krishna wants everyone to utilize his talent as far as possible. Arjuna was a great fighter, and Krishna encouraged him to fight. He never said, "You sit down and I shall do it for you." A teacher's position is always influential. At the same time, your good editorial work will continue. So I think you should accept the position. I am also going to Bombay to try to induce a managing director to give us some concession on the Sindhya line. I hope this meets you well. Your ever well-wisher, Bhaktivedanta Swami.
Jai Swamiji.
An imaginary character. He is real. And information about him is available, but you must receive it from a person who knows him, who can see him face to face. At times, the Lord himself descends and plays his pastimes so that we can recognize him and develop our relationships with him. 500 years ago, the Lord appeared as a devotee in the holy land of India, in a place called Navadvip, where he taught everyone to become his devotee and to glorify him by chanting his holy names. These names, called the Maha Mantra, sound like this. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And this means, O all-attractive, supreme personality of Godhead, please deliver me from this miserable material condition and engage me in your loving devotional service. Would you guys like to try chanting?
Okay.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama,
Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
This is the temple of Sri Radha Madan Mohan. Sri Sanatan Goswami built it 450 years ago.
How did Sri Sanatan Goswami build such a beautiful temple so long ago?
That is a very interesting incident. You see, Sanatan Goswami used to sit under a tree and worship his Madan Mohan deity. As I told you earlier, this was all full of forest, and the river Yamuna used to flow nearby. One day, one very rich merchant was taking his goods for marketing on a boat. When the merchant went to the river, he found to his surprise that there was some tide in the river,
and the boat was sunk in the sand.
What happened? What? Get all your men in action. Quick! Do something. It is already dark. If we get stranded here at night, the bandits will come and plunder everything. They will not even spare our lives. Extinguish the lamp. Otherwise, they will easily spot us.
There is a light.
But I wonder, who will live in the middle of the forest here?
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
What brings you here?
I'm a merchant. I was carrying my goods to the market in a boat. But unfortunately, all of a sudden, my boat got stuck in a sandbar. And we all are stuck here at night. Then we saw this light from the boat. And so, we came to you to seek for your help.
I am an old man. How can I help you?
Please, bless us, so that we can overcome this danger.
The person who can save you from this danger is here. Go, ask him. I told you, go and ask him.
Oh, Shri Krishna, my Lord. Oh, my Lord Krishna, please help me. I promise, the profit I will make from this trip, I offer to you. Oh, my Lord Krishna. Krishna.
He could understand that only Madan Mohan could have answered his prayers. In the transaction, he earned a lot of profit, and he offered that amount to Sanatan Goswami, who has invested the money to build the temple to Madan Mohan, and that is this temple.
The entire nation seems affected by a strange mood.
They call it the counterculture.
I can understand students being influenced by this, but the teachers, it's beyond me.
As a matter of fact, this movement was started by some teachers and professors on the West Coast. Have you heard of Timothy Leary?
Mm-mm.
Or Richard Alpert?
What's their idea?
Their main idea is that you can attain liberation through drugs, that money cannot buy you happiness, and these social moral codes are mere obstacles for real freedom.
My God, does Wheeler take drugs?
I've heard he doesn't even drink coffee or tea.
You want to see me?
Yes, Mr. Wheeler. Please come in.
Mr. Wheeler, I'm sorry to say that we have received some unfortunate reports and complaints about you teaching some ideas, some strange ideas about God.
Is there some kind of restriction on speaking about God in this college?
Mr. Wheeler, we're simply trying to find out here what the situation is. There have been some complaints.
Well, I don't see any validity in these complaints. That's why I'm pointing out that it's totally baseless. I don't think anyone has the right to stop me from speaking about God.
It's not only speaking about God, but some strange concept of God.
When someone has no information about God, how can he decide that my concept of God is strange? At least I have a concept when they have none.
But you're teaching them that God is black?
No, he's blue.
And that he's a cowboy?
No, he's a cowherd boy, and he has a peacock feather in his hair.
And does he carry a gun?
No, he carries a flute.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Swamiji, prasad is ready.
Sit down. I want to talk to you. Are you really convinced of Krishna consciousness?
Yes, of course. What happened?
I am thinking of giving you sannyas.
You mean you want me to become a renunciate?
Yes. Sannyas means complete renunciation by surrendering to the Lord. It is a life of complete celibacy by taking a vow never to get married.
Do you think I'm ready?
What do you think?
I don't know. It's a pretty difficult vow. If you want me to, though, I'll try my best to keep it.
I took sannyas when at the age of 63. You are so young.
Well, I assure you one thing. I'm not ready to get married.
That is very good.
Achyutananda!
Achyutananda!
Hare Krishna!
Hare Krishna!
Swamiji, Achyutananda just arrived.
So, Achyutananda, you had no difficulty in coming to Vrindavan all by yourself?
No, the people in Delhi were very friendly. One lady gave me 5 rupees, then I caught a train to Mathura. From there I caught a bus to Vrindavan. And finally, a rickshaw to here.
How is everybody in America?
Everyone is missing you and eagerly awaiting you. When they receive your letters, they become ecstatic, as if there were a festival. They all sit around, and Brahmananda, Hayagriva, or Satsvarup read the letters out loud. They then make photocopies for themselves to keep as their most precious possession.
I too miss them, my spiritual children.
Hey, Brahmananda, please accept my humble obeisances.
How's everything?
Please accept my obeisances. Srila Prabhupada is coming to San Francisco tomorrow.
Who?
Prabhupada. He's not our Swamiji anymore, he's our Prabhupada. See, Prabhupada means one who is always found at the lotus feet of Lord Krishna.
Is that how he wants us to address him?
Well, he says it's more appropriate.
Should I fly out now?
Why don't you wait for me to ask? Maybe we can fly together.
Okay, I'll stay in touch.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Prabhupada.
So, how are you doing, Hayagriva?
I'm fine, Swamiji.
You look so well.
And so are you. You have fully recovered.
Yes. India was very agreeable to me. Please come here.
Swamiji, I don't deserve this.
Keep it. You certainly deserve it. Thank you very much for all the services you are rendering for Krishna.
Here, Swamiji. Please take this prasadam.
Hare Krishna. Let us now honor prasadam.
Hey, I found someone who might just give us some land.
So how did you find this place?
I saw an ad in the San Francisco Oracle. A man in West Virginia wants people to help establish a religious community. So I got in touch with him. I can't believe we found this
place. He wants to set up like a hippie community or something?
I don't know. He didn't quite sound like a hippie, but he claims to have the truth, and he's ready to impart it to the others. I guess he just wants to be a guru in his own way.
So you think he's what we're looking for?
I don't know. But at least it's worth a try and see what happens.
Yeah, well, give it a shot. Maybe he'll be right.
Look at this place, Hayagriva.
This place is beautiful.
This is just what Srila Prabhupada wants. You know, we have temples in the city already. Now it is time to move out into the country, into the villages. Lord Chaitanya predicted that Hare Krishna will be chanted in every village and every town. We've got the towns, now we're going for the villages. Prabhupada loved Dr. Mishra's ashram. And think about it. Krishna's abode in Vrindavan. It's countryside. He's a cowherd boy. This is going to be perfect.
Yeah, I feel closer to God already.
I can't wait till Prabhupada sees this.
Yeah, it's really beautiful.
Can you believe we found this place? Srila Prabhupada is going to love it.
We have to invite him out as soon as we get our act together. I feel like this is all part of Krishna's arrangement, this whole trip. I don't know what it is, but I just have a feeling about this place. Something big's gonna happen here.
It's gonna take a lot of work. But all we have to do is depend on Krishna.
How are you so confident that this foster guy is gonna give us a good deal and he's not just trying to take us for a ride?
He sounds like a spiritual kind of guy, right? So, we're starting a spiritual community. He should be able to give us the land.
I don't know, he seemed a little too out there.
We have to depend on Krishna. That is the point. We depend on Krishna, and then we can have Vrindavan right here in West Virginia.
Okay. Well, if you say we should give it a shot, then I'll give it a shot.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you guys doing?
Okay, we saw your ad.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
The one in the San Francisco Oracle.
Yep, that's right.
You guys are the first ones to respond.
Terrific.
Come on, sit down. Make yourselves comfortable.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, I got a bunch of calls. And from San Francisco, all over California. There's a few people coming out here in the next couple of weeks. You guys are the first ones.
All right.
Let's see. Kind of a funny get-up you got over there.
I guess it is. My name is Kirtanananda.
Uh-huh.
This is my friend, Hayagriva.
Howdy. What about that pole? Is that a fishing pole you carry around with you?
Not quite. I carry this with me wherever I go. Sort of like Lord Jesus Christ used to carry a stick with him.
Huh. Strange name, strange get-up. You guys are Americans.
Yeah, you can say that. But actually, we're spirit souls.
Well, come to the right place. Huh. Yeah, this place is to cultivate knowledge of the truth. Understanding of the over-self. I inherited this place from my father. Mm-hmm. Been here about 3 years now. Come on, let me show you guys around. I got about 300 acres here. Is the main house, but there's a couple other shacks around the property I'd like to show you. You might want to settle in. Come on, let's get on my truck.
Sounds good.
You know, it's all a matter of opening ourselves up to the forces of the universe. Then the truth can come pouring on in. It's what I call the wisdom of the over-self. And it's the responsibility of those of us who have attained the truth to share that with others. That's what this community is all about, to share with others. You know, I don't care who it is, blacks or whites, communists, capitalists, rich or poor, young or old. Doesn't matter to me. But that's what I'm trying to create here, a community of seekers for the truth.
Yeah, so how's the weather here?
The winters, ugh. Well, the winters, they're pretty severe, but the summers, they're lush and beautiful. I don't think there's any place more beautiful on Earth. You know this place, it's like there are forces. All over the world, there are magnets attracting those spiritual forces. Gentlemen, This place is one of them.
How much land will you give us?
Well, let's see. I can't give you too much, you know, a couple of acres, small parts of the land. Because we gotta save a lot of these for other people. There's gonna be a lot of people coming. We're gonna be together, working together, sharing together. That's what it's all about. Well, are you in or out?
Yes. I think we are interested.
Well, then, we are in business. Gentlemen, I'm going to show you the sweetest piece of property you'll ever want to see. We're going to get out right about here.
Wow, beautiful.
Most of the land's right here. Over 300 acres.
Beautiful.
And my father's land, my grandfather's land. You can't see it from here, but right over that hill, there's a nice little cabin that was built at the turn of the century. I think it'd be perfect for you guys.
Krishna has blessed us with a wonderful opportunity. He is not only sending us many devotees, but some properties as well. Recently, I came across one Mr. Foster who has about 350 acres of land, and he assured me that he will give us a part of it. He is in a somewhat remote part of West Virginia, and the nearest international airport is just over an hour away. Nevertheless, I feel it will be an ideal place for our ashram. Your humble servant, Kirtan Nandaswamy.
Tell him that I am very happy to receive this news. He should try and get this land. When I go back to America, I'll visit his place.
You, who are on the road, must have a code that you can live by. And so, become yourself, because the past is just a goodbye. Teach your children well, their father's hell did slowly go by. And feed them on your dreams, one they picked, the one you know by. Don't you ever ask them why, if they told you you would cry. So just look at them and sigh.
Hey.
Hi there. Is Foster in?
He sure is. Hey, Foster, we got some guests.
Hi there.
Hi. Hey.
Hey, nice to see you again.
Long time no see.
Yeah.
We got a couple of new people here in the farm now.
I see.
This is Tom, Carolyn, and
hey.
Janet.
Hi.
Hey.
They're all from California. And there's a... Reg! Hey, come on over here. This is from New York City.
Hey, how you doing,
good to
guys?
See you. Hey, how's it going, Reg?
So, where is Kirtan Ananda?
He's back in the old farm. Doesn't come down here. Doesn't want to share with any of us. Tell you the truth, I find it kind of strange. Because when you're spiritual, you want to be open-minded. You want to respect everybody's views.
I can appreciate that.
Yeah, we're all on this path together. We're searching together.
So, if we're searching, that means we haven't found it yet, right? Doesn't that mean that you have to approach somebody who's already found it in order to get it?
You sound just like Kirtananda. You guys all sound the same. I mean, that you gotta find a teacher. You need a guru who's going to take you by the hand and lead you to the truth. You know, the truth is inside us. It's inside each and every one of us. We just have to be attentive to the moment, and it's going to open right up.
Well, if that's your view, then fine. You're saying that everyone should respect everyone else's view, then please respect ours, too. Let's just not talk about our differences.
I can dig that.
That's cool.
So where's the back farm?
Well, you just go about half a mile down the road, come to a little path, and you take that up the hill for about 2 miles, and come right to his doorstep.
Can you drive there?
Well, if you got a tank, you can drive, but I wouldn't recommend taking that.
All right. I guess we're in for a hike then.
Okay, adios.
Goodbye then.
Bye.
See you, man.
Have fun.
Hey, Hayagriva.
Hey, Kirtananda.
How are you?
Good to see you. I want you to meet a former student of mine. This is Harold from Wilkes-Barre.
Hare Krishna. How are you doing?
So. Okay. Let's go.
Okay.
We've got to get our stuff.
Okay.
Come on. Come on. So you quit your job?
No, I got fired.
Must be Krishna's divine arrangement. I was praying to him for your association.
Yeah, well, prayers do work. Wait.
What?
I gotta take a breather. That's gonna be tough here, isn't it?
Come on, it's not much further. It's our spiritual abode. Welcome to New Vrindavan.
Morning.
Good morning. Reg told me that I could find you here.
Yeah, what can I do for you?
See, our spiritual master, our guru, he wants you to either sell us or lease us the entire back farm.
Well, I can give you the house and a couple of acres. Not the whole 130 acres.
He really wants us to get the entire farm.
I can't do that. I don't want one group coming in, settling in, and doing their own thing. I want people from different backgrounds, different philosophies coming together. That's what's going to make this glorious. People from all over the world coming here and searching for the truth. Coming right here to my place.
Look, we really need a long-term lease.
Well, I can give you 5 years. Renewable, of course.
Our spiritual master told us, a long-term lease, or we're not interested.
I received the letter from Swamiji today.
Okay, let's hear it.
My dear Kirtananda, we have no freedom of action because the land belongs to Mr. Foster, and he wants to develop an institution appealing to all sections of seekers of spiritual enlightenment. Such an impersonalist ideal can never be successful. Our mission is to reach the supreme planet in the spiritual sky, namely the abode of Krishna. Therefore, we cannot compromise by saying all sorts of meditation give the same result. I think your endeavor in that part of the country will not be very successful. under the circumstances, I would advise you to live with me, your ever-well-wisher, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami.
So what should we do?
There is no need to waste our time. Pack up and go, I guess. So, we're quitting the scene tomorrow.
Whatever you say.
Swamiji thinks that, until Foster changes his attitude, it's not worth our while. We're wasting our time here.
Yeah, I'd like
yeah,
me
no, too.
We're gonna go now. I don't know.
Me too.
Hey, Reg, what's up?
What's up?
Hey, I was looking all over for you all. Foster's been getting paranoid lately. He put lights up on top of the building. He's nailing up no trespassing signs everywhere. They got guns laying around everywhere. It's like we're on full military alert. Last night, a couple of kids from 250 came up, all drunk and crazy, threw firecrackers in the mailbox. The boy's going to survive, but the parents are suing Foster. See, this is what I'm talking about. Foster put up signs everywhere. The guy is paranoid.
Look serious. This has gone too far. Let's talk to him.
Hey, how you doing?
So you found him.
Yeah, we've been talking.
You guys heard about what happened here last night?
Yes, we heard. Reg told us.
Police have been out here a couple times already. Boy's gonna be okay, but the parents, they want to sue. That means it's gonna cost money. And besides, I might not be safe around here. These people are rednecks. They're out to get me.
Do you think they'll be that revengeful?
These people can be vicious. Foster's life is in danger.
I might reconsider that lease proposal.
We need a lifetime lease with all land rights granted, Foster.
I can't do that. Mineral rights was sold off years back. I want a couple trees on top of that hill, so I can't give you the timber rights. But this is what I'll do. I'll give you a long lease.
That will be fine. We will pay $4,000 for 99 years lease.
Hey, what in the world? Blasted groundhogs.
What?
Okay. I'll draw up the agreement. 99 years. Jesus Christ. You guys want to be God Almighty?
Krishna has given you this beautiful place. Now, you take full advantage of his gift.
In order to develop this place properly, we're going to need dedicated people. Not just fly-by-night people who come, stay for a week, and then go.
Yes. The Krishna consciousness movement is meant for sincere people. It is not for the lazy and crazy. A devotee of Krishna will be sincere and hard-working. Don't worry, they will come and help.
But we're going to need people who will stay here permanently.
Yes, some will come. At least 50 men should stay here permanently. That I will arrange.
Haribol!
Vande Mataram Sri Radha Ram 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 Ram
Introduce you to a timeless classic, the Bhagavad Gita as it is. It's written by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. See, here's his picture. This is the definitive English edition. It has many chapters. It deals with yoga, knowledge, Sankhya. Why don't you take a look? Have you ever read much about Eastern philosophy?
I don't know much about it.
Well, why don't you take this book home with you and read it?
Nah, I'm not interested.
Anyway, you have a nice day, all right? You take care, sir.
Hey, what are you giving out?
These are very special books. Would you like one?
Nobody sells books on the street. They're sold in the shops.
Well, I told you, these are very special books.
What's that on your head?
Oh, that's Tilak. It identifies my body as a temple of God.
That's cool. So tell me, what's so special about your books?
Well, this book teaches you how to conquer death.
I don't care about death.
Well, where is your grandmother?
She's dead.
And if she were alive, she'd feel exactly the same way that you do. She'd think she wasn't going to die.
I don't know. I never met her.
That doesn't matter. Did you ever consider that one day you would grow old, just like your grandmother?
Maybe, but I don't like to think about that.
Whether you like to think about that or not, that's what's going to happen. You're going to die. But with these books, you can attain immortality. If you read this book, you will become immortal. You'll never die.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I mean, why else would I be out here distributing this book?
Well, then, I'll take one. How much is it?
Just $2. And please, read it carefully. I guarantee you will benefit beyond your imagination.
Thanks. I will.
All right, take care, okay?
I don't know what's up with these children these days.
I don't know and I don't care.
What is in this book she's reading anyway?
Jenny, while you're in there, get me a beer.
Thanks.
Dad. What do you have to drink?
Hey, don't piss me off. Just get me a beer. I just asked her for a beer.
I know it. Jenny, you better watch your mouth when you talk to your father. I don't know why she is associating with those people anyway.
I want my beer, okay? Just because she don't want to eat meat and act weird don't mean I have to, okay? And you know what? If I want to eat meat and drink beer, that's just what I'm going to do.
That's right.
Where's my beer? I asked you to get me a beer.
Get your father
okay?
a beer right
Why
now.
Look, you know, can you tell her, look at her, see how she's acting? Why can't you get me a beer?
I think it's those books she's been reading and those people that she's...
I want a beer, okay?
Are you listening to what your father's saying?
Them books.
Okay, now look at me. Will you please get up and get your father one beer? Right now. All right, you are so grounded. You are not leaving this house for one whole week. Go ahead. Eat your apples and your bread. Eat some green salad. You're not going anywhere.
Hare Krishna, I don't think about that.
Jen, honey, it's getting late. Won't you come out and help make breakfast, sweetheart? Jen, come on, wake up, honey, please. Come on, Jen, I'm coming in. Jen, my God, where is she? Rob, honey, wake up. Wake up.
What happened?
She's not in her room. Jenny is not in her room.
Hey, Smokey, get the guys together and get over here. Those Hare Krishnas kidnapped my daughter. I already got the go-ahead from the sheriff. Everything's all right. Get over here. Hurry up.
The spiritual nature is diametrically opposed to the material nature. Therefore, they are in constant conflict. And when you want to make spiritual advancement, there will be so many obstacles and impediments. But we should never give up. We must carry on with determination and conviction. And when we want to try to make progress on this path with sincerity, then Krishna will help. Obstacles will be there, yes. But if one remains fixed, then the obstacles will not only disappear, but they will become stepping stones on our spiritual path.
Get away from him. Sit down. Leave him alone. Back off. Sit down. Who's in charge here?
I am.
Where's Jenny?
Is there anybody here by that name?
Okay, we'll do this the hard way.
Yeah, the fun way.
Hey. Come on. Brass, Smokey, come with me. The rest of you guys make sure nobody goes anywhere. Move it, move it. Come on, move.
You guys are some serious freaks. I'm gonna love blowing you away.
Hey, wait a minute. I got a better idea. Let's let him dig his own grave.
Hey, start digging, freak.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Now is the time when the real test comes. I must be firmly fixed in the knowledge that I am not this body. I am spirit soul.
Didn't I tell you to shut up?
Look, I'm about to die, right? So what difference does it make if I speak a last few words?
Here's your last words.
Why don't you do it to me again? Do you think you're hurting me? Do it! Hit me again! You're not hurting me! You're hurting this flesh! I don't need this flesh! Hit me again! Go on! I'm not this body!
No, let him dig. I don't want to be here all day.
Get up here! I want to see how far you can throw your statue. Bill! Come up here, Bill! Chop that statue down!
Rama.
We ran away, but the devotees are afraid they might come back and launch an attack again. We reported to the police, but the police are not cooperative. They're refusing to file a case, even though two devotees were shot and are still in the hospital. It seems that they are rather happy that we have been attacked.
The atheists and demons will attack us, and we have to be prepared for that. As a matter of fact, the more we succeed, the more severe their attacks will become. But no matter how hard they will try to stop this movement, they will never succeed. Krishna will eventually take care of them, just as he did to Ravana and Hiranyakashipu. However, It's not that the devotees will become callous and incompetent. Krishna's devotees are not weaklings and cowards. When necessary, they will encounter with these demons, just as Arjuna did. Don't be diverted by these attacks. Continue to render service. We will build new Vrindavan in West Virginia.